We are the Alpha and Omega. We worship you, our Lord. You are worthy to be praised. We give you holy. Our Father and our Lord, we thank you. Holy Spirit, we worship you. Lord God Almighty, we adore you today. We praise your name. Jesus, the Son of God, we appreciate you. We thank you, Lord. We worship you, God. We adore you, Father. We give you all glory. Take absolute control today. Speak to us from your throne. Open our ears of understanding and our heart of acceptance in the name of Jesus Christ. Break away every stony heart and let the heart of flesh be planted to receive the word and grow and germinate and produce the fruit after its kind in the name of Jesus. We give you glory, Lord. Father, we pray for a good atmosphere for this word, Father. We come against noise. We come against distraction. We come against spirit that bind and sell. We come against spirit that misunderstand word. We cancel principalities and power. We frustrate their intentions. We command it to release the heart of men and women to receive your word, Father. In the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, take control. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Last week, the Lord gave us a message about from the parable of the widow. He gave us a message from the parable of the widow. And today, we have another message. And we thank God because the Lord loves us so much in this garden, no matter how things are at the present, the love of God is so strong upon our lives. He's faithful. The Bible says the Lord is good unto those who do what? Unto those who do what? That seek him. Unto the soul that love him. Amen. The Lord is a faithful God, and he loves us so much that he gives us regularly messages. We don't just preach sermon, but we deliver message. I woke up today with another message, and this message was related to the last Sunday, to the extent that I was even querying, I was telling my wife, I don't know what God wants to bring up from all this issue of the parable of the widow. He gave me another one today related to the last week and also Bible passages. And I know the Lord is sending message to her. It might not be a woman, it might be a man. And like I always do, I will explain the revelation before I continue into the message. This time around, there was this woman. The woman was happy with her husband. It was like a play that was shown to me, just like last week. The woman was happy, the husband was happy, living happily. And all of a sudden, there was this strange man that comes. He says, "What do you think this your husband can offer you that cannot offer you? He cannot even good you. If I not give you half of what I can offer you, I can change your life. I can give you." And he began to make promises. He began to make offers. He began to talk and talk and talk and talk and talk. And the woman was listening. Initially, the woman pretended as if she was not interested. He said, "Oh no, I don't care about what you can give." I don't care about what you are. I don't care about how much money you have. I don't care about what you can offer me. But my life is sold up to another man. And that is who I have decided to be with. Therefore, leave me alone. Depart from me with all your offers. But unfortunately, after the man departed, the word began to develop in the heart of the woman. And she decided to terminate the life of her husband and to go after this man that was making offer. She designed a plan, which I am not going into, because that is not the that's not where the message is. I will go where the message is. And she succeeded in terminating the husband. After termination, she rushed quickly to grab all her things and go back to the new man that made offer. To the greatest surprise, the new man said, "Do you think I was ever interested in you? All I was interested in is to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Your husband is dead. Your life is miserable. I do not need you." Double tragedy. Double what? Matthew chapter 4. I will read from verse 1. Matthew 4, 1 to 11. I will read this one myself. And I want you to follow me. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights afterwards, he was hungry. Now when the tempter came to him, he said, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become bread." Number 4. But he said and answered, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3. That's where Jesus quoted. Verse 5. Then the devil took him up into the holy city, set him on the pinnacle of the temple, and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your feet against his own." Devil quoted from the Psalm 91. Who says devil doesn't know Bible? Listen to verse 7. Jesus said to him, "It is written again, you shall not tempt the Lord your God." Jesus quoted Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 16. Verse 8. Again the devil took him up on the exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdom of the world and their glory. And he said to him, "All these things I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Verse 10. Then Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve." Exodus 23, 25, Jesus quoted there. Then the devil left him, and behold, angels came and ministered to him. Angels came and ministered to him after the temptation. Amen.
Amen.
The parable of the widow, part 2. The parable of the widow. And I want you to be very careful, attentively to this. Amen. John chapter 10, 7 to 17. John chapter 10, 7 to 17. Mr. Clare, can you read for us?
John chapter 10, 7 to 17. I read in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Then Jesus said to them again, "Most assuredly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All whoever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep do not hear them. I am the door. If anyone enter by me, he will be saved, and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief does not come except to steal.
The thief does not come except to steal.
And to kill.
And to destroy.
I have come.
That they may have life.
That they may have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. But a hireling, he who is not the shepherd, one who does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees. And the wolf catches the sheep and scatters them.
Hold on. That's break. We're still going to 17. Just hold on. You can see them. I will still have to stand up from that 13. You see, I want us to look at it. You have been reading this place, but I believe God will give you a clear revelation about this place. As I'm talking, God will be showing you the picture. Because when you see picture, it's more than what I'm saying. Amen. I want us to refer back to that revelation of the woman. The woman was deceived into offer of a better life, better opportunity, better advantages. And she believed. She did not believe at first, but the word grew, the word germinated, and the word became flesh, and it manifested, and she took decision to the extent of killing the husband. I will be going into the meaning bit by bit, and you'll be seeing it even before I get there by the word that we are reading. Devil made offers to Jesus, didn't he? He told him, if you do this, I will give you this. I will make that happen. I will do this. But we give glory to the name of the Lord. The purpose of the coming of Jesus was not aborted. When I read that passage over and over and over, that Matthew 4, before God gave me inspiration of what happened, what actually happened there, I was always thinking devil came there in person. And he was picking Jesus around, and he was talking to him, and they were fighting. I discovered later that everything happened in his mind. Somebody that was fasting, you know, there will be a time you'll be walking around. He separated himself. He might be on the mountain or desert. You know, you'll be walking around. You know how much power God has given you. You know what you have done. You know what you are in Christ. And you begin to walk around. And you begin to look at yourself very important, very big, very great, very mighty, and begin to imagine things. But Jesus was tempted, but he was not defeated. He held strictly to the word of God. I will come back to that when I'm finishing. But what I want to look at now is the assignment of the devil that he came into the life of that woman in picture. That was the devil, the strange man. The woman is you and I. The devil will come all the time, telling you better options out of what you are passing through, giving you ideas, giving you anything, and how to give you a better life to come out of what you are coming. And when you cannot get a contrary or a word in the Bible to fight that sinful imagination, you are defeated. Every word that Jesus quoted was found in the Bible, because I took my time to look for them. He quoted Bible throughout. If Jesus could quote Bible towards any of us, then I don't think we have any word or any of our story to say, we don't have any right or any talk to begin to vindicate ourselves, say, I merit to be defeated. Because, no, the Bible has given us every word you need to fight every evil content of the heart. Every idea, every message that the devil preached against your salvation, against your belief, against heaven. Everything is written in the Bible for you to fight it. Until, if you listen to the part, why did the devil give up? Devil has no more Bible passage. Have you noticed that? He did not, the last one, he just got out of the Bible. He said, okay, if you bow to me. Because he was tired of the Bible, he said, this man knows Bible. He now said, okay, let's make a worldly flesh to flesh offer. If you bow to me, I will give you this. And Jesus quickly answered him back with the Bible. We'll soon come back to that when I'm finishing. We have talked about this before in one of our messages, overcoming by the word of God. You cannot have any permanent victory except the victory of the word. The Bible says this is the victory that overcomes the world, which is our faith. And I told you that time, I said, faith comes through hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Nobody has faith without the word of God. The level of the word of God you have determines the level of your faith. And that is the faith that you need to overcome the devil in all temptations. That is not where we are going. We want to maintain our focus on the woman. And now the strange man came, he made offer. And the woman went to meditate on the offer. The woman saw that the offer was good and juicy, and she was ready to risk her marriage and the life of her husband to obtain the offer, which she did. But she was disappointed. John chapter 10 was telling us, the thief cometh not, but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. That was the picture of that revelation. The thief came because the thief saw the man came. He saw the woman happy. He saw the woman at peace. Had everything going on. Love was there in the home. Happiness was there in the home. Provisions was there in the home. And everything was nice. And here comes the enemy. The purpose was to withdraw the peace in the house. The purpose is to destabilize the woman. And he knew that if I can take away this man that provides so much, the life of this woman will be miserable. And the purpose of God for this life will be terminated. And here he appeared like a man that was interested. Made an offer. The woman fell, the husband gone, and her life became miserable. And she was never, in that revelation, never focused again. Sorrowful, painful, bitter. I'm still focusing on where I'm going. So John, we're still reading John 10. The only one that has a plan for you is the one that created you. Jesus is saying here, he said, I am the true shepherd. I am the one door. Any other door is what? Counterfeit. The only door, what he's saying indirectly is that every word that I tell you is the only one that can take you through life and to take you to heaven. Every other teaching, like we said in Bible study today, our Sunday school today, every other teaching about economics and mathematics and social sciences or money management, anger management, nothing can take you out of all those anger except the teaching of the Lord Jesus Christ. Have you seen somebody that they talk about managing anger that got out of anger? What they only tell you when they say anger management, which means they're telling you how to manage your anger. You can get angry, you still begin to, you know, manage how you hit somebody. I was watching TV during the week. In the Greek, they interviewed some Greek politician to the TV. A politician, a younger, very young man, had prospect, opportunity in life, and hunger destroyed his career that night. Very young man, I don't think he's up to 30, or early 30 at most. And some elderly women that have been in politics before he was born, sitting down around the table on the TV. And because the election is coming, and this man happened to be opportune to be faster in life, to go into that kind of, to break into that kind of place. And here is the door open, and here is the man destroyed the door. He shut the door with anger. Everybody sat down, they just asked him a question that got him angry. He stood up, he took the glass of water, he threw it first at the one of the journalists. On the TV, national TV, he threw the water, and when he got up, he went to the woman.
The woman, if you see the two of them, the woman is far elderly than him. On the TV, and Al Jazeera showed it, BBC showed it, every other TV showed it. It became world focus. And from there, they said they called, only they detained him in the TV station there. From there, he broke away, ran away. Now the career is gone. Reputation is gone. Who will choose that kind of person to be any leader in any country? He will be slapping everybody in the country. That's what they will be saying. Devil cometh not, but to steal the right and opportunity. No teaching can take you out of devil. What people don't know is that devil is the giver of all those teachings. And he knows how to have his way through them. No amount of marriage counseling can put peace in the home, except the teaching of Jesus Christ. No amount of money management that can manage money except Jesus comes in the home. Devil cometh not but to steal peace, to take away the joy, to distract the people, and to steal whatever they have. But Jesus Christ came to give us a life, and a life abundantly. When devil steals away joy, he makes the life miserable. And why is he making life miserable? To distract them from coming back to their senses, to trace back their source. Where is their source? The Lord God, through the Lord Jesus Christ. He does not want people to trace back their source. He just wanted to get miserable until he takes their life. And when he takes their life, he now takes their soul. You see some people, the devil took, there was a man, I think in China, he was against the politician, and he was jailed for, I think, 25 or how many, since 1985. He came out from coming out of the prison, the next thing is to take his own life. What does that give? A wasted life. 22 or 20 something years wasted in prison first. He now came out because he was angry against the government. He wanted to show his anger. How can you show your anger by killing yourself? Is that not stupidity? Is that not foolishness? How can you take your own life to show that you are angry with the government? It doesn't show any sense. Devil cometh to steal. Devil stole away his 20 something years in jail. The time is supposed for true foolishness. The time is supposed to do tangible things, useful, successful, creative. He was there. And he came out instead of him to trace back his source, which is God. It's only God that can change a country. If you like, you can keep 1,000 people can kill themselves because of a country government. It does not change anything. They don't even care. All they just feel is that this person is angry about us and he died. Some of them will be laughing. This one was very crazy. You think his death can change anything? Your decision and your knowledge and what you believe does not change anything about your life or the country you are living or the law or anything. What changes is tracing yourself back to your source. Making sure that devil does not rob you of any right you have. We have rights. We have opportunity. Jesus realized that he had all this. That was why Jesus did not submit to all the evil imagination. I want to go quickly. He's saying further that anyone that does not hold the sheep does not care about the sheep. The husband of the woman cared about the woman. The husband could lay his life for the woman. But this wolf does not care. But he will pretend to care. Oh, I will care for you. I will do this. But as soon as you find yourself in a scam, it does what? It changes. What is it? But you are the one that told me. What did I promise? God, and it become the real, it turned back to his real self. That's the way devil does. The only one, that's what Jesus was saying here. The only one that cares about you is me. It's my Father in heaven. That's what he has sent me to tell you. He is the only one that cares about you. Devil does not care. Don't listen to his promises. Don't listen to what he's telling you. We go about with precious people in evangelism. If you see the way some people talk, they believe in devil, but they don't believe in God. How can you believe in devil? How can you believe in all those phantom and all those evil things, ghosts and spirits? And you now see, you come to God and say you don't believe God exists. Then he gives room for question mark. How can God not exist when all those things exist? That is not true. This is the doctrine of the devil. To paint everything. And we Christians, we are helping that to stay. We are helping devil to be magnetized by preaching the gospel of deliverance, for instance. You will see a man of God preaching for 1 hour about what devil can do, about what witches can do, about what demons can do, about everything, but speaking little about what God can do. By doing that, we are magnifying their powers. It is good to speak about what they can do. I'm not against it. But we blow them too much than blowing God. And this world begins to know much about evil spirit and devil, and they don't know much about God. God is not shown to them. Devil is shown to them most. Evil things are spoken more than when a child begins to speak. Have you ever seen a baby when they speak? What did they say first? No. Negative. No. No. Every child that speaks for notice, keep notice. You will see, no. Give me, no. Everything that people know for us is negative. Positive is not taught. We don't teach people positivity. People learn negativity in all situations. Even when you go to a country, you are learning their language, you know the bad things first. Am I speaking true? Go to Spain, go to France. When you begin to learn their language, you learn how to insult people first. Am I speaking true? Does anybody experience that?
Yes.
My sister, when you were learning Spanish, what do you know first? How to insult people. They show an American citizen on TV one day was speaking. He learned Yoruba from Ibadan, and they brought him to the TV, and they said he should speak. He said, "Olushi." I said, "You see, it's insult." You know, insult first. So what I'm saying is that people paint bad more than good. People speak negative more than positive. And people, that's the reason why majority of our generation know about devil more than God. It is high time we begin to speak more about God. What does God do? What can he do? How big he is? How great it is. What are your experience about God? The only one that cares about you is God. Devil does not care about you. Anyone that give you offer, please, anyone that make any offer to you that is not a child of God, it is a question mark offer. Devil does not know how to give good to anybody. Any offer that comes from any person that is not a child of God, it is a question mark. Because nowadays people will say, "Oh, this that's the Lord's doing." The Lord, I know God can send unbeliever, but you must ask him. He's the one that does everything. A man of God was speaking on TV the other day. He said an unbeliever just came, somebody just came to him. I don't know whether believer or not believer. Said the man used to be a huge businessman, and he had trouble with his finances. And the man took one of his books and read, and the man hit a jackpot. I don't know how. In business, and the business revived again, and the man came to him with and the man came with him with a briefcase full of money. He said, "Take," and he took it. He said, the briefcase was full with a lot of money. I am not saying to receive this is bad, but what I'm saying is that before a child of God receives anything, find out, is this person born again? Or you can pray to God. Sometimes God speaks, but when you see the money, because we need it, we don't want to listen to it. Because God might want to do something from refusing or from taking. So this thing that I'm saying does not mean that God will not use unbelievers to bless you if he wants. But not all cases. In most cases, money is used to buy salvation. Money that is given to you today can take you out of your way. It takes a process. Money is used to buy calling. If you see this minister I'm talking about now, they don't have any preaching of the gospel or cross anymore. And And they started very well. I know them when they started in the 80s, early 80s. They were just preaching like those Pastor Kumuyi, like those men of God that preach the true gospel. But now, and they never know that they are deviated. They have not realized that yet. It's only God that can save those souls. So what I'm saying is that only the person that cares about you is God. If you want to place resources in your hand, it will use its own children too to bless you or bless you occasionally. But you must find out whether it's the one. Don't just jump at any offer. Verse 13 to 17.
Verse 13 to 17, I read in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The hireling flees because he is a hireling and does not care about the sheep.
He doesn't care about the sheep. His agenda, his plan is all about the sheep. He just wants to deceive and destroy and take away their salvation and send them to hell.
Amen. I am the good shepherd.
I am the good shepherd.
And I know my sheep.
I know my sheep.
And I'm known by my own.
I am known. My own sheep too know me.
As the Father knows me,
yes,
even so I know the Father.
Uh-huh.
And I lay down my life for the sheep.
Mm-hmm.
And other sheep I have which are not of this fold.
Mm-hmm.
Then also I must bring, and they will hear my voice.
Uh-huh. You see, he said, although I have a sheep that know me, and there are some other sheep too that don't have the same kind of fold, but I've still sent to them to bring them to the knowledge of me. Do you understand that? To still bring them to my knowledge. I am not saying this one that know me are the ones, but there are some people that are still in the world today, that are still living in the world. They still need to know me. Their name, that's what I said yesterday. I said, those people, that lady we preached to, and after preaching, she took her cigarette. I said, you will not be surprised that her name is in the book of life. Because she is part of the fold that will still come back to know. And she has just started the process. By the time she gets home, the things will be going on. Jesus will take over from there, and we need to show revelation. And revelation, it might take, God knows how, it might take 1 day, 2 days, 1 year, 6 months, but I'm sure she is part of the kingdom in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Can you finish, Matthew 17?
And there will be one flock and one shepherd. Therefore, my Father loves me, and because I laid down my life, that I may take it again.
Amen.
Amen.
He said there will be one flock and one shepherd. One flock and one shepherd. And the only flock that is established, that is recognized in heaven, is the flock that preached the gospel of Christ. And the only shepherd that established in heaven is the shepherd that preached the resurrection, the death, and the life of Jesus Christ in holiness and righteousness. That is what the church of God is said to do. The church of God is said to preach the gospel of heaven. The reason why we are seated here today is not for us to dance. It's not for me to teach you how you can go home and make money, or how you can go and apply for anything you want to do, or car or house. The reason why you are seated here, because you are saved. Like that woman yesterday, she has been saved, isn't it? If she now goes to a church, what does she begin to do there? What kind of message is she expected there? How to grow. Now, if the kind of woman comes here now, and now begin to say, oh, my sister, you need to grab a mortgage. You know, when you need to get 21 ways to get mortgage, you know, the sister will just sit there like, what is this pastor talking about? I need one. I am hungry. I just got born again yesterday. I don't want to buy a house. All I want is to make heaven. And the pastor comes the next Sunday. Hallelujah. 21 ways to get out of debt. My sister, are you in debt? The Lord is here today. The sister says, oh God, what is this pastor talking about? I need to make heaven. And there are many children of God like that in churches. Those that are God's, they want to hear from him. Those that are not of God, they want to hear the mortgage and debt and some other things. Those things are good. I am not saying it's bad to speak it to members, but let them come to your office After service, you teach them how to get there. But in the church, not everybody is meant to hear that message. Some people are crying inside, and their cry is reaching unto heaven. They want to grow. They want to make heaven. They want to break through. I am telling you sincerely, if you can seek God the way you need to, if you can accept Him with wholeheartedness, you will have the wisdom to live your life, and the life will have meaning. Because God is the only one that gives wisdom. Those things that they teach in the university, it was given to one person. Why do they have university? It's because the knowledge is not equally distributed. God did not give everybody the same wisdom. Therefore, somebody was naturally gifted to be a medical doctor in the old generation. That God gave the wisdom to be first medical doctor. Now the person will now say, what can we do? We have to put it in the university. So that all people that want to be, that don't have the knowledge, they will pass through university and begin to do it. And in the course of their doing it every day, regularly, they begin to develop new avenues, new methods, discover new. Every medicine that is used to cure people is from the herbs and plants that God created. God gives some people wisdom to discover it. So why do we neglect the Lord and believe in the things that He created? He is everlasting Father. He is the King of Kings. He is the Ancient of Days. He holds everything and anything in His hand. And He's in heaven seated. The Bible says He does whatever He wants. Amen.
Amen.
He is the only one that has a plan for your life.
Amen.
He said His plan and purpose for you is good and not evil. To bring every good thing that you want about your life to pass, and to also take you to heaven. He does not care about you making heaven alone. He cares about you making this world too. He said it in His word. He said, anyone that abandon what? Brother, sisters, family, and things, for His sake, He will make sure they have it in hundredfold.
Amen.
Is it heaven? Did He say only heaven? No, He said in this life and also in the life to come. So God cares about your life, not only heaven. The only thing that's stopping Him is we. I thank God, some of you were there yesterday, we were preaching to a man. The man said, all I want is to have my house. All I want is to have a house. I am homeless. I'm sleeping on the street. He didn't want to hear gospel. He said, are you ready to help me? We said, please, we know we need to help you. We can't tell you, you cannot know what you want to do. But hear first the gospel of Christ. Because the Bible that we know is to seek first the kingdom. The man did not want to hear that. All he wants is that, can you give me a house? I'm telling you, if you give that kind of person a house, they will turn it to beer parlor. And they will do everything. Because the man was not, he was not interested in the gospel of Christ, but in the things that he needed. Are we seated here today? Are we seeking Christ because of heaven? Because we love Him, or we are seeking so that He can take care of our trouble? Do we take God? Do you have a relationship between you and God? That's my question. Are you a child? Have you been identified by heaven as a child? Or you are God's user? There are some God users, I used to say it. We must get past that. We must not be God users. We must be child of God. Don't go to church as religion. Go to church as a child that wants to have a communion relationship with Father. I was telling some people on Friday, I said, when you go to, I asked my son Junior, I said, when you go to school, do you call your school a religious place? Because it's a relationship, it's not religion. And therefore, a husband and wife cannot call their marriage religion. It's relationship. And therefore, you knowing God as your Savior and Jesus Christ is also relationship. It's not religion. Therefore, when people ask me, say, what is your religion? I say, I don't have religion. They will first of all laugh. Say, you don't have any religion? I say, I don't have. All I know is that I'm a child of God and I have a relationship with God. That's my religion. The Bible says, one what? One flock and one shepherd. One flock and one shepherd all over the world. One message and one preacher. every preacher must preach heaven according to what he said in the book of Mark 16. Every preacher must preach the death, resurrection, and the life of the Lord Jesus. That is our assignment. Healing is not our preaching. Deliverance is not a preaching. Miracle is not a preaching. Financial breakthrough is not a preaching. Jesus Christ is a preaching. He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. He's the Lion of Judah. He's the one that gave us life, making us sit down the way we are seated today. And we have not given any other message apart from Christ all over the world. From the north to the south, from the east to the west, Jesus Christ must be glorified. Amen.
Amen.
Matthew 24, quickly. 23 to 28. Matthew 24, 23 to 28. Matthew 24, 23 to 28.
Matthew 24.
Yes, ma'am.
Matthew chapter 24, verse 23. Then if any man shall say unto you, Lo, here is Christ, or dear, believe it not, for there shall arise false Christ with false Christ and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, in so much that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect. Behold, I have told you before. Therefore, if they shall say unto you, Behold, he is in the desert, go not forth. Behold, he is in the secret chambers. Believe it not. For as the lightning comes out of the east and shines even on to the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Verse 28. For wheresoever the carcass is, there will the eagles be gathered together. Verse 29. Immediately after the
28. Thank you very much, ma'am. You see there, don't forget, I will refer back to Revelation all the time for you to understand every Bible passage we are reading. The man went to deceive the woman. Say, look, I can offer you better opportunity. Look, I can give you good advantage. And the woman fell for it. The Bible says, they will come to you. Jesus is here. Jesus is there. Jesus is this way. Jesus is the other way. So you must make sure that you are not deceived. You must stand on the doctrine that you know. You must stand on the cross, the rock of ages. You must stand on what you have believed. Amen.
Amen.
Because he said, even they will come like an angel of light, false prophet, and they will deceive even the elect. He said, they will deceive. He said, even the elect, the people that are chosen, will be deceived. Because the gospel will look so much the same. There will not be difference between it. That is why the elect will be deceived. But you will find out quickly that they have some things. God will quickly reveal to you that they have some agenda apart from what they preach. But many people will not be able to discover, because they have been handed over to destruction. But if you are lucky and fortunate, if you have God that gives you inspiration that this way you are going is the wrong way, that is when you will be called back. Many people don't have opportunity to turn back. A lot of people went back to the world, and the devil quickly took their life. Don't forget, the devil cometh not, but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Anyone that loses salvation, the next thing the devil will be looking for is death. Oh yeah, kill, fire, because we already took the salvation. Fire quick, and they'll be running around. They'll be running around. How do we terminate? How do we destroy? How do we? Very dangerous. Very dangerous. Devil still killed, destroyed. But the Lord has come to give life abundantly. If you are seated here today, since you believe you have done sabbatical and the Lord has brought you back, the Lord has written your name in the book of life. I'm telling you, it couldn't have happened to anybody except he or she that name, whose name has been written in the book of life. Because devil does not waste time. He doesn't waste time to take life of those people. He will be making them go through the valley of death. Quick, quick, push it, push it, push it. And you see those people moving fast, fast. And it's to destruction. And they want to plant some seed that will make it in difficult to turn back. We'll soon get there very soon. They plant some seed. Do you know there are some people after they fall back into sin, there are some things they did, they can never confess it openly. And that thing will not hold on to heaven. It will not hold on to the key of heaven and say, you confess now. Say it publicly. And you will not hold on to that thing. That person will not be struggling. Why, God, why did you allow me to go back? Why? Because I went back and fell into this thing. Oh, Lord, have mercy. And that is the way the devil does. He pulls quickly. If some people are still calling, praying for them, that they should come back, they should not die, they should, you know, God, that's why I say God loves those people. Because God will reveal some people what the devil wants to do. And the prayer will be going on. Prayer rain. Oh Lord, this sister must not do it. This brother must not do it. Oh, when the devil now knows some people are, carnal weapon. You people are using against this sister. You want to capture me? You don't want me to take her? Okay. He will not create another way to fall that person into something that cannot be spoken about. To hold on to that salvation. Because salvation is devil's trouble. That salvation you say you go and find is his trouble. He doesn't like it. May God have mercy on us in the name of Jesus. Every plan of the devil against every life is dead here today. The heavens we have bought them today. In the name of Jesus Christ. Watch out what messages you are hearing. Watch out what people are. They can take some context in the Bible and they will use it to create their own ministry and their own doctrine and their own pattern. That is not what they are after. They are after your salvation and soul. But they will take what you know. But you begin to know it through their word. The Bible says through their seed, you will know what? You will know them through their fruit. When the way they speak, God, Holy Spirit begin to minister to you and say, do you see that? They will say another thing, Holy Spirit will tell you, do you see that again? They will say another thing, Holy Spirit will say, do you see that again? Run for your life. By the time you carry your Bible, say, brother, me, I don't go. I don't want to come here again. Even for that to happen, God really loves you. Amen.
Amen.
God really loves you. Luke chapter 9. Luke chapter 9, 57 to 62. Luke 9, 57 to 62.
Luke chapter 9.
From 57.
Luke 9, 57.
Yes, ma'am. Five, seven. Now it happened, as they journey on the road, that someone said to him, Lord, I will follow you. I want you to listen to this passage. Lord, I will follow you wherever you go. Verse 58. And Jesus said to him, now, I want to explain that before I continue. That's the confession we make when we receive Christ as our Lord and Savior. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No. Everybody said that day when you met Christ, but watch what happened. This person said, God, I want to follow you. have decided with all my heart. 58.
And Jesus said unto him, Fools have holes, and bells of the air have nests. But the Son of Man has not but the Son of Man has not where
he lays his head. You see that? It is good when somebody gives their life to Christ through you or through enemies for them to tell them, you tell them what they are into. Some people don't know what they want to go into. They don't know the kind of journey they want to embark on. They think it's journey of happiness, journey of liberty, journey of greatness. We only preach to them about the good things they will find on the way. We didn't tell them the challenges to build their faith. Because faith can only be built through challenges. How do you know that you have faith? How did we know that Abraham had faith? It was because of the challenges. It was because of hard times produce your faith. It shows how strong you can be. It is not there to kill you. It is not there to put an end to your life, but to show how much resistance, how much of God you have in your life. That is why you must explain to them. Those periods will come that God will want to know how they are, how they have grown. The word of God that they are reading every day. This place is a classroom. When you go out, it's where you experience what we teach here. Now you begin to see it happening. Don't cry when they happen. It says, I knew the purpose of trouble. I never cry anymore. Because they are there to build you. The Bible says, it is only those who overcome that will go to where? Heaven. You don't want to overcome, you want to go to heaven. When they say overcome, can somebody overcome without wrestling? No. You need to wrestle before you overcome. The Bible did not say boxing. Have you seen the Bible say boxing? Because boxing, you do like this. You give, you go back. You give, you go back. But wrestling, you hold yourself. Somebody must go down before you overcome. And the person that must go down is the devil.
Amen.
You will wrestle and the person will go down and you overcome, then you make heaven.
Amen. Jesus.
The other time I was teaching to some people here, I said, you don't run away for yourselves. I was telling the sister, if you run away for yourself, you cannot make heaven. The God wants you to overcome your anger. That's why he provides somebody that will torture that anger. And he wants you to overcome that anger so that you can be qualified in heaven. You can never know you have anger problem unless God provides somebody to challenge it. You can never know that you can lie unless God puts you in a situation of tithe for you to go out. The Bible wants you to be tried. That's what the Bible says. You'll be tried and pruned, and you'll not be glorified because you have gone through all stages. It will be partiality and unrighteousness of God to let you live a beautiful life and not take you to heaven. That will not be right. It's not good. You'll be cheating other people that are not born again. But for you to know, how long can I bear situation? Do I have the spirit of long suffering? God will not say, okay, take this one. Try it. And you now begin to struggle with that sister. Oh God, how long can I hold? And that is to try your long suffering. You will not see another time you are in a tight situation, everybody is pushing you. That's your try whether you can still tell lies under pressure. You will not see yourself in another situation. That's your tell whether you can get angry under pressure. When you are being tried, I'm telling you, problem can go away from life forever. You will not see them again.
Amen.
When God has finished with all that area, when there is no longer anything held against you by the accuser, you will live the rest of your life happy.
Amen.
But before that happens, God needs to be sure. He will tell the devil, say, that is my daughter. I have tried everything. If you want, you too go. God said that to Job. And the devil went and
he failed.
Yes. He can do that. And that's what he's doing to you, if you don't know. That's why when you remain only in your house, where I'm not there, you don't see that like this in the church. You begin to face your temptation alone. You don't need to do that. Because it is something that God is trying to bring out of your life. You don't need to do that. It is good to feel bad. That is allowed. Job felt the same way. But Job did not cry or spoke back to God in a bad way. Because Job realized the purpose of those trials. We must watch out. When we are going those problems, don't let anybody come and give you another alternative. That's where I'm going. To say, oh, God, we can offer better than this. What kind of belief do you have that make you look tattered and rough like this? And look at where you even look. Look at your body. Look at your life. You are. We have a easy way. We too, we are going to heaven. Are you saying we are going to hell? Eh? Are you saying we are going to hell? Look at the way I dress. I still have my chain. I still have my makeup. I still have everything. We're still heading to heaven. It's a lie from the devil. The Bible makes me realize that anyone, Joshua 7:13, if you still have anything to belong to him, you are for him. We will read that place very soon. Let's finish this one.
Verse 59.
Yes.
And he said unto another, follow me. Then he said, Lord, suffer me first to go and bury my father.
You see now? Jesus now told them the real thing. Somebody that said want to follow. They now told them, say, me, I don't have also. If you are ready to bear all my yoke and my trouble, no problem. What did he say? He just give an excuse. Say, in that case, Jesus, I think I want to go and bury my father. Is it today that the father died? You know, because he just heard that it was not an easy way. He just gave an excuse and turned back. What did another one say?
Jesus said unto him, Let the dead bury their dead. Then go thou and preach the kingdom of God.
You see, he said, let the dead bury their dead. But you go and preach the gospel. Remove your focus on the trouble. Preach the gospel. Even when it's not convenient for you, preach the gospel. Even if you don't now have money in your pocket, preach the gospel. Even if you don't have food on your table to eat, preach the gospel. Even if you don't see anything happy around your life, you are not happy. There are some days we went to evangelism that I was not happy. But people will not notice. There are days we went there to preach that I didn't go with happiness. Even the day, that Saturday before yesterday, I was not really happy. There are some things I was going through emotionally. We just went there, and that one thing God did just make me happy. Maybe God just allowed that to happen so to change my mood. You see, so most things you do things, you are not really happy. But when you preach the gospel, but when you are happy, the heaven rejoices. The devil gets angry. Say, upon what I'm doing, upon the pressure, upon the everything, this woman still have mouth to go and preach. Here? Upon the way I'm... devil will pressurize your landlord against you. He will pressurize those people you have issue with not to give you because he wants to solve one problem or the other. Even the people that hold you, he will tell them not to pay you. Because he's driving at something. And when you see all that, you still keep on singing. With your shoulder high up and your head up. Because you still continue to sing, I have decided. That song you sang many years ago, keep on singing it every day. Even you take the whole world, take the whole thing, take the whole money, take the whole cars, take the whole situation. But my salvation is unreachable. Job said it. He said, even in chapter 13, I believe, verse 15. He said, even if he kills me, can somebody put finger in that one and read quickly to confirm? Job 13:15.
Though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. But I will maintain my own ways.
But before him. My own assignment is to maintain my own way. It does not matter what he does to me. Amen. And that was what Job held on to. And the Lord gave him victory. Amen.
Amen.
So please, yes, let's finish what we are reading. Are we up to 62 or 61?
No, we are in 61 now.
Okay.
61, and another also said, Lord, I will follow thee, but let me first go them farewell, which are at home, at my house. And Jesus said unto him, No man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God.
You see that? He gave his life to Jesus. He said, I have understood you. But with this all this condition, let me go and say bye-bye to my people first. So that I know that I'm in trouble. I know that I'm... And what that means is that, let me go and sort my home first. Let me go and make money to take care of my family, my wife, my children, to look for the way I can take care of them. Because I know that I'm embarking on a very serious and dangerous journey. And my family will have something to fall back on. There will not be any trouble. And that is why Jesus responded, No one is what?
Fit.
Having put his hand on the plow, looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. That is one of the places we are going. I'm moving towards conclusion very soon. No one, nobody, after you put yourself on the kingdom, you give your life to Christ, you turn back, the Bible says you are no longer qualified for heaven. In other words, second chance is difficult. Second chance is like they want to go to operation and the doctor said this is 50-50 chance. 50% of success, 50% of death. That is anyone that finds the kingdom of God and lays and turns back into the world. I used to know a brother. When I first got born again, he was also one of the workers in the church, very fervent, going on a crusade tour and everything. And all of a sudden, because of the pressure of having a good job, he started from one thing. The brother forged certificate to get job with SSS, you know, the State Security Council, State Security something in Nigeria, with those people that used to do bodyguard for the governor, president, and all that. He started from forgery. Because of pressure, he got the job. From there, the devil took over. Later on, he didn't show up again in the church. Before you know it, the brother disappeared from the house. I'm telling you a real life story. It's not something they told me. I was there at the church in that time. The brother, the wife did not know where the husband go. The wife and the children, he just disappeared from the house. Up to the time I left Nigeria, he had not come back home. Nobody knew where he went to. The devil cometh not, but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Once salvation is lost, devil will be looking for soul in death and in hellfire. We must be careful. Watch out for the least thing, because devil does not come big. He comes in a small way, and the small way will give room for the bigger ones. We must be careful. See the way he came to the woman. He took advantage of the woman. The woman lost everything. And he was at the verge of claiming a soul. Because first of all, he make you lose. Second, you lose the life. Third, go to hell. Devil has hellfire in mind for anybody he comes to. But he always shows himself as a good brother, a good uncle. Showing good offers, good advantage, making gospel easy. God, devil will tell you that the gospel is not difficult. It's not, don't mind these crazy people. It's not as tough like that. You don't need to be like that before you go to heaven. I am telling you the truth, I am not lying to you, and heaven bears me witness. Because anything I preach, it's been revealed to me. God made me realize one time, I think around December or November last year, your life in Christ only is just the beginning. But your perfection is what takes you to heaven. Giving your life to Christ, that's the stage of everybody in all churches all over the world now. They gave their life to Christ, all of them, but nobody is working towards perfection. And perfection is needed to go to heaven. Nobody wants to be perfect. They say perfection is not easy. Nobody can be perfect. Therefore, we give up. And the heaven need a perfect person. How do we go about that? I told you on Friday, I said, any message you listen to every day is what you do. That is why I have put it upon myself. I said, God, if I must make heaven, if every member that you put in my charge must make heaven, I will not preach anything apart from this until the day I depart from this world. I will not preach any other thing apart from heaven, salvation, holiness, righteousness, how people can perfect their life, how people can live. The only thing me I can teach, I cannot teach 21 ways to be successful, but I can teach 7 ways to perfection, 21 ways to holiness, 23 ways to righteousness, 110 ways to go to heaven. That's what me I know how to talk about. That is how I can flow. If I want to tell you how you can be rich or make it now, I might not be able to say that. But if you come to me personally, you have financial trouble, God will give me wisdom to advise you. But what is given is what we must do, is to preach the gospel of Christ. And what is the gospel? That Jesus came to the world. He died for the sinner. He rose again. That we must reconcile ourselves back with our God and prepare our way to meet our Maker. That is the gospel. Amen. We are getting to the end, and we have 2 more Bible passages. Let's read quickly. John 8, 34 to 37. John chapter 8, 34 to 37.
John chapter 8, 34 to 37. Jesus answered them, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever commits sin is the servant of sin, and the servant abide not in the house forever, that the Son abide forever. If the Son, therefore, shall make you free, ye shall be free indeed. I know that ye are Abraham's seed, that ye seek to kill me, because my words have no place in you. I speak that which I have seen with my Father, and ye do not, and ye do that which ye have seen with your Father."
Yes, continue.
Verse 39. They answered and said unto him, "Abraham is our father." Abraham is our father. Jesus said unto them, "If ye were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham."
Okay, pause, man. You continue to later a little bit. You see that? They claim to be children of Abraham. We are Abraham's children. We are children of God. We are child of God. Many people say that now. In fact, many Christians in all churches, when you say some of them, you say, "I'm a child of God. I know I'm going to heaven." That thing you are talking about does not matter. It does not mean I'm going to heaven. And Jesus answered, said, "If you are truly Abraham's sons," what happens? What did he say?
You will
do the works of Abraham. A child is known by the works of his father, by the image of his father, by the look of his father. How can you claim to be a child of God when you behave like the devil? Continue, man.
"That now you seek to kill me, a man that had told you the truth, which I have heard of God. This did not.
Jump to 42, man.
Verse 42. Jesus said unto them, "If God were your father, you would love me. For I proceeded forth and came from God. Neither came I of myself, that he sent me. Why do you not understand my speech? Even because you cannot hear my word. Ye are of your father, the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in truth.
Because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources. For he is a liar and the father of all lies." You see, he is a liar and father of all lies. That is the revelation I first talked to you about. Devil lied to the woman, and the woman followed the devil, and she became devastated, rejected, confused. The reason why the devil came is to steal our salvation, to steal our joy, to steal our happiness, to steal our peace, and to take the life and to also take the life to hellfire. Please, I beseech us, brothers and sisters, as we are speaking, as I am putting the message to an end, don't let the devil rob us of our salvation. There is no other way that we might be saved. There is no other place that is conducive and good and happy than heaven. The Bible says sinners cannot live forever. We just read it now in John chapter 8. No sinners can live forever, but the righteous, if you live a life without sin, you will live forever. You will not die in the body. Any sinner, when they die to hell. And their death is forever. But when the child of God closes eyes here, it's just like you close eyes and you just cross over.
Amen.
You just begin to live on.
Amen.
And before you close your eyes, some people are waiting to take you.
Amen.
As you close, they just say, you are welcome, servant of the living God, let's go. And you move on from there. What can be more desirable than that? What can be more joyous than this, to see yourself living this world and going to your glory? A place where there is no sorrow, a place where there is no walking, a place where there is no more pain, a place where there is no more tears, a place where there is no more sorrow, a place where there is no more commitment and family trouble. You don't, when I want to joke with my family, I say, you don't pay tax there anymore. You don't pay electricity anymore. You don't pay water rate anymore. You are free like a bird. You are happy. You are joyful. You'll be singing, looking at the glory of the kingdom every morning when you wake up. Just watch the flowers. Take a stroll on the street. The Bible says it's a street built with gold. Walk around, enjoy your sight, and go and rest forever and ever and ever and ever. Where some people are on the other side, say, yay! Ah! Oh! Yay! They told me I didn't listen. They gave me advice, I didn't listen. That bushy hair pastor, he used to say it all the time. I did not listen to him. I did not even like the message. I was not always comfortable whenever he's saying it. I was not. And the heaven will not show face to show you the pastor. He said, that is Pastor Samuel Drew there. Look at him in his glory. That is the kind of thing. Anyone that calls himself a child of God, that's where he's telling us that you hate the word of your father, you are not a child. The word of your father includes everything about life. Our perfection includes everything about the teaching. That is what we do here. And that is what I will continue to do forever as long as I live. To preach perfection is the reason why people sit down in the church. To show them how to live to make heaven. That is why they have come here. We go on the street to which so. We bring them to the church to make them grow. To please their maker. We are not out for business. We are not here to call people and say, we are doing a program, come here. So that we can increase and we make money. And we dance to the bank every day. That is not the reason why Jesus came. Jesus did not die for us to make money. Jesus did not die for you to receive healing and go and smoke. Jesus did not die for us to receive deliverance and go and fornicate. Jesus did not die for us to come and get whatever in the church and go and do as well. Jesus died that will win soul and the soul will stay and remain in the church. And then we begin to ask anything his father, he begins to do for us. Make up your mind today. Who do you believe? Who is your God? Are you living to receive temporary blessing, or are you living to receive the blessings of heaven? Let's finish in Revelation 2, 1 to 7. Revelation 2, 1, 7. Our last Bible reading. Revelation chapter 2, 1.
Revelation chapter 2, verse 7.
1 to 7.
1 to 7.
Mm.
Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things.
Can I read it, ma'am, because of time? Thank you, God bless you, ma'am. To the angel of the church of Ephesus write, these things says he who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks in the midst of the seven golden lampstands. I know your works, your labor, your patience, that you cannot bear those who are evil. And you have tested those who say they are apostles and not,
and have not, and have found them liars, and you have perversed and have patience, and have labored for my name's sake, and have not become weary. For nevertheless, I have this against you. How can that be? He's just saying that I know your work. You have been doing good things. You have mixed yourself with the people that lie to be the apostle of Christ, and they are not, and you have been revealed to you. And I know your zeal. I know your passion. I know that you love me. I know that you want to keep my word. I know that you struggle to live for me and to make heaven. But I have one thing against you. Despite all your passion, despite all your hard work, despite everything that you decide to do for me, what does it have? I have this against you, that you have left your first love for me. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the first works, or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from its place, unless you repent. But this you have, that you hate the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. Verse 7. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. Anyone that overcomes will only eat from there. What is your work that he knows? He said, you have lost. The Lord has sent me to you today. That your first love for him is missing. Your love for him is cold. You have lost the first passion when you gave your life to Christ. You have lost the first love that you have for him. Your love is growing weak. Your love is growing weak. Your love is growing weak. He loves you. He wants to save you. He died for you on the cross. He saw how you struggled to please him. He knows that you love him deep-heartedly in the bottom of your heart, but you are not putting great pressure. You are not applying enough strength to overcome the flesh. The flesh is struggling with your right. The flesh is grabbing and taking you away and out of his presence. But he says he knows what you are passing through. He says he knows that you are struggling to please him. He knows that you are struggling to live holy and right. He knows that you love to live in his presence. But he says you are not struggling enough. Your passion is not enough. Your love is not enough. And how can you revive that? Is by thinking about your first love. How did you behave when you gave your life to Christ? What joy came into your heart when you gave your life to him? What were your moves that time? Are you the one that you always, the track is always in your hand every time when you give your life to Christ? My sister, take, God bless you. Even when you are not doing evangelism, your personal life, everywhere you go, the track is in the hand. Check your first love. Every time you go to your house, you pray 4, 5, 6 times a day, but now you struggle with one. Every time you read your Bible, the Bible was your novel, it was your magazine. But now, you try to clean up your Bible once in a day, and in a week, when you want to go to church, you just wipe it and you carry it. Your first love. Your first love. The love for Christ. You know what I'm talking about individually. Everybody knows when you gave your life, the way you felt, the way you moved, what came over you. Everybody around your neighborhood was asking you, Sister Emuwai, what happened? Sister Danella, what happened? Sister Antonia, what has come over you? This sister has gone strange, eh? She has gone strange, and we don't know what is wrong anymore. That time you have a huge move in your heart to preach to anybody. Every day that you wake up, you want to preach. Anywhere you go, you want to see something. Even if you cannot speak, you want to give something like a tract to somebody. Your first love. Your first love. Rise up on your feet. Oh Lord, my Father, bring me to my first love for you. In the name of Jesus, begin to pray. Oh Lord, my God, connect me back to my first love for you. In the name of Jesus, connect me back to my first love for you. Oh Lord, my Father, I need my first love for you to be reinstated. I need my first love for you to be reinstated. I need my first love for you to be reignited. In the name you. Have mercy on me. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
You will pray this prayer and you will cry to heavens. Oh Lord, my Father.
Oh Lord, my Father.
I must not go to hell.
I must not go to hell.
My Father and my God.
My Father.
I must not go to hell.
I must not go to hell.
Have mercy on me. Cry bitterly to the Lord. Look at me. Hug your body like this. And you cry to Jesus. Jesus Christ, the Son of God.
Jesus Christ, the Son of God.
I know my body is not going to heaven.
I know my body is not going
to heaven. My soul goes to heaven.
My soul goes to heaven.
Do not allow this body to send me to hell. You are here today. I'm not calling anybody out. You just sit down where you stay as you are staying. You know in the bottom of your heart that your love now is different from when you got born again. You cannot compare it. It's different. And you know that it's not like before. It's going cold. You need to renew them today. You will now speak to God. Raise up your two hands to God. Oh Lord, my Father. Precious Lord, oh my hand, lead me, oh, let me stand. I am old, I'm tired, I am weak. Restore back to me. In the name
name of Jesus. Father, lift me up, Lord. Lift me up, Lord. Lift me up, Lord. Let my first love be restored. In the name of Jesus, let my first love for you be restored back to me. In the name of Jesus. 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 Lift me up, Lord. Raise me from the grave of both my heart.
Spirit of the living God, come fall on me. Spirit of the living God.